In the last episode, you learned about elastic jobs and why you might consider using them. In this episode, Kate's going to dive into the two fundamental concepts you need to understand before you create elastic jobs. This week on Data Exposed. Hi, welcome to this episode of Data Exposed. I'm Anna Hoffman, and today I'm joined again by Kate Smith, a PM on the SQL DB team. Welcome, Kate.
Yeah, thank you for having me back.
Happy to have you back. And on the last episode, we talked about elastic jobs and more of an intro of when you might use them and where they're supported. And we definitely recommend you go watch that video before this one. And this one, Kate's going to tell us about some of the fundamental concepts. So, Kate, I believe you mentioned there are two fundamental concepts. Can you tell us a little more about what those are and what they mean?
Sure. So there's two sort of pieces of groundwork that it's helpful to understand before you dive into trying to create elastic jobs. The first concept has to do with the way you structure the T-SQL scripts that run when you execute your elastic jobs. And that concept, the name for it, is idempotence. In essence, the script must be idempotent. It must be able to run on a repeated basis without causing problems, right? So, and by problems, I mean that if you are adding a column to a table, you don't want to add that column and then accidentally run the script a second time and add that column again, things like that. And then the other sort of concepts is having an understanding of the complicated sort of credential system that's used to authenticate and run elastic jobs. So those are the sort of two concepts.
Awesome. Thanks, Kate. And you know, that first one you're talking about, idempotence, you know, it makes sense. You know, we want to make sure we're not creating extra columns or that sort of thing. And I'm guessing, you know, maybe I can write some extra T-SQL to do that. You know, how do you advise people make sure this doesn't happen?
Absolutely. So it's a simple modification, basically, to a T-SQL script that would, where you are creating something or you're updating something, you basically can just do a check, you know, making sure that the table you are adding columns to doesn't already have that column, making sure that column isn't already created. So you can do some sort of existence check, or if you're doing a stats update, you can even like check for when the last time the stats were updated before you go off to update them, to make sure that they weren't updated, you know, just 20 minutes ago, that they were updated, you know, within the amount of time that you want for the period of your elastic job. So if you're trying to update stats once a day, you want to make sure your stats are at least, you know, 23 hours old before you execute this, basically. So you just check for the condition, you know, does it exist, or is it basically stale enough before you go off and execute the T-SQL? So it's just a modification at the front, you know, or basically wrapping your T-SQL before you execute it, a barrier.
Awesome. Yeah. And, you know, that makes sense. And it seems like these simple checks or like the little bit of extra effort that it might take to put these in is really going to save us in the long run. So that's awesome. And if we move to the second one, you started talking about credentials, and I don't, you know much about them. So can you tell us a little more how you might go about setting this up or what it means or anything like that?
Yeah. So I think that the first thing to understand is that when you're running Elastic Jobs, you have a database set up that has the host of the Elastic Job agent, okay? And that is where the jobs are running from. And that those jobs need to authenticate to your targets. So basically the things that you're connecting to run your Elastic Jobs against. And so it makes sense that you would need to have credentials to connect to those targets. Now, right. And so you need to, but the way we do this is to keep those credentials secure. We create those same credentials on the Elastic Jobs agent host, right? That keeps them secure. They're stored as credentials. They're safely stored there. So any credentials that you need to run that T-SQL over here or to connect over here, you need to like basically mirror on the host database. So that and then configure the Elastic Jobs to use those credentials when connecting to execute.
And where is this host running?
Yeah, sure. So it's often on a separate server or separate database. It would be in its own database, often in a different server than any of the things that you're targeting, right? So it's running in Azure on just some other server. It can be any sort of, general purpose database. Does not need to be fancy schmancy or anything like that. It basically stores the job, connects to the targets, and then executes.
Got it. Okay, so we need the host to have access. Makes sense. Yeah. Are there other credentials that we need to think about?
So there's two basic types of credentials. One, we call it the refresh credential. Okay, you can configure Elastic Jobs to run against every database on a server. So basically, when you add new databases to that server, it would be automatically, those databases would automatically be picked up and become part of the targets for any Elastic Jobs you create. So this is a really streamlined and powerful way of just you target that server and every database gets hit unless you explicitly exclude it. And so that's nice for maintenance purposes, that you don't have to go and keep adding new databases right to some master list or anything. It just does it. And that what the thing is, in order to support that, you have to have a credential that allows you to connect to that server and list out all of the databases on that server. And so that we call that the refresh credential. It refreshes the set of databases that it's targeting in a server. So when you create this this Elastic Job Agent, you also have to create this, we call it master cred or refresh credential, because it's basically what's used to refresh those jobs, and it's the same credential used for every server that you target. It's not stored separate for target. It's stored for that job.
Gotcha.
So that's the refresh credential. And then there's another credential. We call it the job credential. So every Elastic Job can have one or more steps. And each of those steps runs with a specific credential that is defined. So in those targets, there would be, there's a credential that has to have the permissions to execute that T-SQL if you were connected directly to that database. You know, what credentials do I need to execute this T-SQL statement? And so every job has one or more steps. Each step corresponds to a specific set of T-SQL and a specific credential.
Gotcha. Okay, so setting up these credentials, it seems like it can take some time, but I believe you actually have a blog post where you walk us through how to go and get these set up, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, it's not that hard. I think that it's basically just doing something on the target and then doing it on the Elastic Job Agent host machine and going back and forth to make sure that you have all the credentials created and that everything can authenticate correctly.
Gotcha. Awesome. Cool. Well, thanks, Kate, for joining us today. You know, we learned about the fundamental concepts, talked about Idempotence as well as credentials. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if you enjoyed this video, we encourage you to like it and subscribe because Kate did one earlier, and I believe we have a few more planned. Is that right, Kate?
Yes, we do. Yes, we do. We've just sort of scratched the surface.
Yeah, so be sure to tune in next when we talk about part 3 for Elastic Jobs. Cool. Thank you.